There's a long stretch of time and tide between the salt marches in India in 1930 and the salt marshes of New Hampshire today. Yet there is a clean salt wind blowing over Seabrook today, the selfsame wind, perhaps, has caught up the sparks of Gandhi's first act of nonviolent civil disobedience and set the fire of liberation in the hearts of the people of India. Drink in that wind.
I've swallowed enough radiation. It's time I was standing my ground. So I'm joining that grand occupation. We're shutting their power plant down. We're shutting that power plant down, my friends. We're shutting that power plant down. I'm joining that grand occupation. We're shutting that power plant down.
First off, does everybody know what a role play is? It's taking a situation of conflict that you're anticipating to happen. It can be anything, with, you know, from get to confrontation with the police to a confrontation with a roommate or a confrontation with a boss or something like that. For different people to take different roles. We could have people who will be occupiers, and a couple people play press, a couple people play police who would be standing there, maybe two people playing armed guards. Maybe someone playing a dog. We haven't talked about the attack dog. Maybe to have someone play a judge and do the situation very briefly of the arraignment, because you won't have a trial tomorrow.
We got a job to do. It's nothing against you and your people, but we just wish you'd go home and leave this place alone. Public service company told us we're supposed to be here. Now, you just tell them they go on home, they're going to get arrested, then take them away.
Stop, you're right here, sir. On private property, you're entering public service company. We're here to protect it, their rights and responsibilities.
We're here to plant corn.
You take your corn and go plant it on your own property.
That land is going to be put back to what it was. Land that can go through the courts if they don't like it. They can go through the courts. This is a free country. They can go through the courts.
Well, you can't come on this side. I'm going to have to arrest you. Take you away. Well, you're not going in.
You know.
Role playing is just what it says. Playing. We're playing like, you know, just like a kid. We're imagining. And so you put into it, into a role play, many times things that actually don't happen. But I think they serve a value in that to people who are uninitiated, those who have not faced this type of thing, it will give them some type of an idea. Maybe what could take place and give them some idea of possible reaction.
Go back home.
Well,
make it easy for us all.
I'm here to stop the construction on the plan. I mean, we're going to be nonviolent, and we're not going to resist you in any way, but we're still going to try to get on that side.
All right, all right. She's half a woman now.
All right, now the rest of you just go on home now.
We don't want any problems.
All right. Not going to have this town taken over. Come on. That one.
Get a picture of that, for God's sake. Stop hurting him. You
know? Can you beat up on everybody that's going to come down here in the future?
I got a job to do. It wasn't me. I got my wife. I got my kids to support.
I hope you have a little few words to say to him.
Well, I didn't see him. You know, I don't know what you're talking about. I didn't see him.
To feel that the situation has been faced and that, yeah, this, my goodness, this could have happened, or to see the expressions on people's faces and to hear some of the names called and try to see how one would react. And I think it might leave some residue there so that when you do face a situation that's somewhat similar,
mm-hmm.
you might think of maybe what you did or what somebody next to you did
mm-hmm.
as a possibility of what you might try.
Oh, you're saying, give me a chance.
Who's the leader here?
I'd like to talk to the leader.
Folks, I got to tell you that you're here in violation of the recent court injunction.
This is one warning only.
You have an invitation.
One
you're under arrest.
Excuse me, are you arresting this reporter?
Yes, she doesn't have permission
to come.
Excuse me,
do you have an invitation? Do you have an invitation to be here?
Yeah.
I'm
afraid
we're going to have to take you down to the local jail.
If you'd like to walk home, Governor,
could you give us a hint? You're going. Here we go. He's out of here. It's a neat point that you made, and you also made about being a 30-year-old construction worker watching it on TV, that you didn't know exactly what we were doing. I guess we somehow must have assumed that everybody knew what we were doing going there.
I was still sitting, and I was thinking maybe I should get up and go to that person that they had half dragged off and just, you know, take his hand again. I didn't know if that was a good thing to do or not, to get up and walk over. What do you think?
I would imagine if you're not particularly threatening the person by doing that, and you want to express some sort of concern for someone who's being dragged.
And it made me really uncomfortable because it was my job to arrest them and to take them over. But I had to answer them. I had to answer their questions. And it puts you in a difficult position.
When you are being face to face with questions about what kinds of questions were they asking you that made you have to participate?
Do you understand the reason why we're here? How do you feel about the power plant? Mostly trying to explain their own position.
So I felt some tension at first. It seemed like if it was real and really getting into the role playing, that there was some tension there, that you were with this officer. And for me, it dissipated as soon as I started talking with her.
And after somebody answered a question, it was just silence. And I was just, I don't know, that's what's going to happen to me tomorrow if I'm asked a question. I'm not going to be able to. I don't know what to say, you know, like everything happened so quickly. I don't know.
What I find with myself when I'm able to do this, it's that one has made up her mind that one's going to act a certain way or not act a certain way. And I think when you know in yourself that even if it comes to dying, which is of course the ultimate, you're not going to do it, then that's it for you. You're not, in a sense, you're not worried about it anymore, in one way.
Mm.
And it's that the other people have to worry about it, and very often they will respond. Now, they don't always.
There were at least 1,000 of us who were on the front steps of the Pentagon, and we were surrounded by National Guardsmen. And a lot of the people in the movement to occupy the Pentagon were very hostile, and most of them were carted away right away. But we sat there, and people got into, like, talking to the National Guardsmen, and the leaders of the National Guard, the officers in the National Guard, got so paranoid that they changed the line, the front line of National Guard, every 20 minutes. And after, I guess we were there about a day and a half, and 3 National Guardsmen defected in the middle of the night. They dropped their guns and snuck into the crowd, and they took off their uniforms and were given new clothes.
When I really get down to it, it takes me about, depend upon the situation, from 5 to 10 minutes to really get with it. And after that, I concentrate first on the people who are handling me. What is my attitude towards these people? And immediately I begin to see them as human beings, but misled and doing what they think their job's supposed to do. And that's what everybody does, you know. People who go to build these nukes, it's their job to go and do it, you know, and it's a reasonable position, you know. And you got to understand this. If you can understand people going to work every day and working at these plants and making all these devilish things, and you don't think bad of them, I do, I mean, about as much, then I cannot think bad of a guy who better beat my brains out because he's a god, and I say, and he said, do this, and I said, well, I can't do it, and he's ready to beat my brains out because I think I have an understanding why he does this.
Visionaries always try to share their new understandings with their neighbors. They try to convince, to reason, to legislate change, always to no avail. They, in their turn, must confront the ancient dilemma of the conscientious, whether to accept a legal evil in violation of conscience, or to resist that evil, even if resistance violates the law.
Small group of people are going to try to attempt to communicate to Public Service Company and to the rest of people of New England in a human way. That means we're going to offer ourselves as a sacrifice in order to inspire people to think about what it means to occupy and what it means to allow a nuclear power plant to be built. And we hope this is going to be very disciplined and very gentle action that's coming up.
We can go beyond that, beyond the road.
We should go beyond that.
Beyond the road, because there's better. Beyond the road, there's a new road. There's a swath.
Oh, wow. Let's take
the new road.
Why don't we just take a left and bust into the woods before you get them, and just walk slowly and collect and find the road that's beyond them and keep going.
You've scouted this area out already, right? I think we go with the people who've walked it, okay? And could you take the lead and... Can we have a consensus about working it out with people who've been the route before?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So Rennie, you're up front.
Yeah, but we got. I know.
Everybody feeling okay?
Yep.
We're not fooling anybody by what we're going to be doing on August 1st, and then we should go straight in from whichever way we go in from, with our trees in hand or in packs, and just walk right and get onto their property, and then together as a group we'll be confronting arrest.
I would recommend that kind of an action more than one where you get into a kind of outmaneuvering or trying to go a whole lot around the swamp, because I kind of think the upfront, open persistence and patience really communicates the dignity of what you're doing.
And any time that we can prolong an action and make it a longer thing, I think that's to our advantage, because it just gives people more time to think about what this conflict's about.
Well, certainly I know from the training sessions that we've had that they've got a great deal of respect for the people of the area. They have a real respect for the policemen's lives. They want to be able to reach the policemen. They have a tremendous love for people and for the land, and it's that love that's the impulse, that's the force that's making them do what they're doing. And I call that nonviolent.
If we decide to go the non-cooperative route of arrest, we will then lie down or sit down when confronted with arrest, and they have to carry us a number of hundreds of yards in order to get us from there to cars or trucks or whatever in order to cart us out.
Depending on how long you can get for doing what you said, I think I tend to agree with that kind of action, in really going limp and making it as difficult as possible that way, not chaining myself to anything, but going limp. But I need to know what the charge for that would be, and if it's going to be more than 30 days, I don't know whether I can do it.
I would non-cooperate as far as the paddy wagon, and then I would hope that there would be opportunities to talk. I don't know that the police are pro-nuclear. I don't know that the judge is, and I would hope that maybe some sort of dialogue could go on.
All the way they were being dragged and carried, that's the conversation that they were having. And it really, by the time they got to the vans, some of these policemen who had been treated in that fashion were feeling pretty rotten about the whole scene.
In the beginning, they were doing their best to hurt people and make it really uncomfortable. By the time they got to the end, after all this talk, as you're getting dragged away and seeing people taking that punishment and just letting them do it, really freaked them out. And they got to me and the women and Jeff, they were a lot easier on people.
They were all taken physically mm-hmm. from the place.
Well, is going limp, do you think, an act of violence?
Violence? No, ma'am. No, June, I don't. I didn't say they were violent. Mm-hmm. No, at no time were they. Did I think any of them were discourteous or violent. Mm-hmm.
The people who are doing civil disobedience will gather at the rally in a separate place from, you know, as the time comes closer, will be separate from the rest of the people. The marshals at the rally site are going to have to make sure that folks who are not planning on doing civil disobedience don't end up going on down the road with those who are. We are not going to use Rocks Road, the road that they've both times used the police wagons to come out of. And we feel if we go down Rocks Road and we block the police in, that they may get kind of panicky. So we're going to make sure we don't end up, you know, sort of physically cramping them. A lot of people are going to refuse bail. The people refuse bail primarily because it's an inequitable system. Poor people spend all their time, pre-trial time, confined in jails because they can't afford the high bails given them.
I think that the need or the feeling that there is a need for people to stay in the can if there is bail set is not as important as the, it doesn't deserve the importance that the people are putting on it to stay in the can if bail is set. I would argue for people getting right out of the can and going back to work, because that's what the whole idea of a symbolic occupation is all about.
Yeah, I don't quite see it that way. I see a lot of weight behind refusing the bail and having our day in court.
I appreciate your point of view.
This is the power we have, is to say that we're not afraid to go to jail. Now, once we're in jail and they say, well, would you like to get out for $25? That's going to weaken our willpower if we go ahead and accept that and we get out. Because we've really become afraid of jail, we're not going to be willing to go back.
So, our position is very clear. We've talked with the police, we've talked with the Attorney General, we've talked with the media. Everyone knows where we're at. Right? Nonviolence. People need have no fear of us. Anything that happens in terms of provocation, in terms of confusion, disruption, we can assume this comes from someone who wants nuclear power, not within our group, all right?
The demonstration, it was just really, really beautiful. There was an incredible community spirit, and with a consciousness and awareness that we knew that we were in the right, and that this was one of the only ways that we can go at this time. It's just been incredible.
What do you
just
think
incredible.
Of the nonviolent tactics?
Well, I think that they've been proven in other parts of the world as being very, very viable force, and that we now in America have to get off of our duffs and get out there and begin telling them with our body in a very physical way, you know, that we're going to put ourselves online, it's going to be nonviolent, you know, and this is one of the ways that we have to get this message across. Unfortunately, it has to be that way.
What was it like inside the armory?
Again, the spirit was very, very high. There was a certain amount of electricity that moved through the crowd just in waves at certain times. When we got certain good news from the outside, or when people had something really positive to share, which was quite often. With the police, the relationships were very, very good. I mean, they treated us very well, far beyond our expectations. We were prepared for the worst. And fortunately, it never got to that point.
Do you plan on coming back and being arrested again?
I'll come back and be arrested as many times as it's necessary in order to stop these nuclear juggernauts. Absolutely.
But the fact that you never know how people are going to react, and particularly how police are going to react. What they don't understand, and what also often happens to them, they are thrown off guard, thrown off balance, is when they come in with you with all their rough stuff, not only with talking rough, but then acting rough, that you, even under that onslaught, can stand up, or when you speak with a great deal of calm and quietness and concern for the person who's doing this. This is absolutely devastating to most people. That now you're behaving not because you're afraid this way, but you're behaving because your sense of humanhood suggests this is how you behave, mm-hmm. even so.
And you can never tell quite always what you're going to do, and certainly not what those that you're confronting are going to do. Mm-hmm. And I don't think you can do it on that basis, that if I act in a certain way, the response is going to be thus and thus, because I think one doesn't know. What I do feel is that when one has made up one's mind to do something, there's no leverage there to work on you. And that just opens the way, the possibility for something to happen.
But you know, this is not a confrontation. We're not here to confront the governor. We're here to talk with the governor.
Right.
And this, I think, is what we would really like to do. And
we're trying to act as representatives of communicators from the 2,000 people here. And we know the governor's here, and we thought it just as a kind of a show of good faith to have some kind of dialogue going on.
What could we take back to him? That you intend to stay indefinitely for a week? As I understand it, you have stated that you are occupying the site until nuclear construction stops.
That's right. That's the goal, yes.
Now, do you mean right here at this spot?
Right up here on this?
On this hill.
Hill, where we are, yeah. That would be our hope.
In America, you certainly have a right to an opinion that is opposite that of other people. Mm-hmm. You do have an opinion that is opposite to what I have with respect to nuclear power. So you came, as I understand it, to let the world know that there is another side and that you represent that other side.
Right.
Okay. Now, on the other hand, you understand that you are here against the laws of the state of New Hampshire. You are trespassing here. And we cannot tolerate that. Now, whether it happened to be a nuclear plant, whether it was a refinery, whether it was a nursing home, we cannot permit the violation of the laws.
Yes.
And this is a tremendous weapon. It said one way, it's a tremendous attitude to say it in the more creative way, to have. You are able to maintain a certain type of behavior because you now have heard the number one thing that all of us fear, and I fear every day also, the matter of death. You go into a situation and you're not going to be made to do certain things because of fear.
We're seizing this land with a vision, revealing the PSC shams. And I sing of my happy condition, surrounded by acres of clam. Surrounded by acres of clam, my friends, surrounded by acres of clam. And I sing of my happy condition.